Yeah.
Yes, sir. It is clear, sir. Video also
sound is clear, no?
Yes, sir. It is clear, sir. Shall we start the program, sir?
Shall I share content?
Yes, sir. We will first introduce, then we will start the program, sir. I will convey within 10 minutes to you, sir.
So, sharing the content, shall I do later?
Yes, sir. You may do later, sir. Later, but later after 10 minutes, you can do, sir.
Shall I share the content?
Sir,
now or after introduction, I will share my content.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Very good morning to one and all present here. I am very much happy to be part of 7 days faculty development program on revised accreditation process of NAC, the paradigm shift for strategic enhancement of higher education system in India. It's a great pleasure to organize this 7 days faculty development program during this COVID-19 pandemic period. I am thankful to each and every organizing members, secretaries, technical team, management principal, faculty members who are all cordially supporting us. And also I welcome each and everyone, especially today's resource person. Let me first start the program with the welcome address. Now I invite Ms. Deepalakshmi Madam to propose welcome address.
Good morning to all, and I glad to present a welcome address on this occasion. First of all, I thank to the Almighty God for this successful Day 7 FDP program. On behalf of our management, principal in charge, IQAC coordinator and IQAC members, and our organizing secretaries, I cordially invite you all on this occasion. And we expect your cooperation to fill the program. And once again, I welcome you all. And I welcome our chief guest, Dr. A. Loudraswamy, St. Xavier College, IQAC coordinator. I invite you, sir. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you, madam.
And thanks for all the participants who joined this program with us. And thank you one and all, and welcome you all once again.
Thank you, madam. It's time to introduce our chief guest, Dr. A. Loudraswamy, sir, coordinator, St. Xavier College, Palayankottai. May I now request Dr. B. Manjula madam to introduce our resource person.
Yeah, sir, thank you. Good morning, everyone. It's a great honor for me to introduce our resource person today, who is going to talk to us about the topic teaching, learning and evaluation. This is a subject in which we should all be deeply interested. Today we have an eminent person, Dr. A. Loudraswamy, MSc, MPhil, PhD, Associate Professor of Mathematics, St. Xavier's College, Palayankottai. At present, he is IQAC Director. He plays various crucial role in the development of his institution. He having a 33 years of academic experience and a very strong administrative experiences too. He acted as UGC visiting committee member for Swachhata ranking to access the institutions on 2019, MS University Tirunelveli and JP College of Education, Alangulam. He served as a chairman and an expert member for NAC SSR preparation and mock visit for NAC peer team visit in several colleges like Laila College, Chennai, SNS Rajalakshmi College of Arts and Science, Coimbatore, Nazareth Margosis College, Nazareth, Government College, Rajamundri, Andhra Pradesh, St. Xavier's College, Jaipur, Rajasthan, Sarah Tucker College, Tirunelveli, Jai Raj Annapakkiyam College, Periyakulam, and an expert member for conducting academic audit in Scott Christine College, Nagarkoil, Lady Duke College, Madurai, Sarah Tucker College, Tirunelveli, SRNM College, Sathur, St. Mary's College, Thoothukudi, Ayyanada Janaki Ammal College, Sivahasi, and Pope's College, Thoothukudi. and reviewer for published papers and books in Mathematical Reviews, American Mathematical Society, Zentelblatt Math, European Mathematical Society. He is a life member of Indian Science Congress Association and member of American Mathematical Society. He published 95 articles in national and international journals. He conducted more than 20 seminars. He was attended more than 60 seminars and conferences in national and international levels. For this, he visited Dubai also. There is a paper in the international journal in his name, Ludusamy's Conjecture in Utilitas Mathematica, and a thesis written in the title, Ludusamy's Conjecture in Pepping in Graphs in China. Our guest of honor has effectively contributed in the field of research. He have 331 citations, 9 H index, 8 I10 index in Google Scholar, 34 citations and 3 H index in Scopus. He received 3 minor research projects and 1 major research project from UGC. He acted as MS University nominee for Board of Studies in Department of Mathematics, Sadakathulla Appa College, Tirunelveli, St. Mary's College, Thoothukudi, Fatima College, Madurai. He received appreciation certificate by Ministry of Finance, Government of India, Central Board of Direct Taxes in bronze category in recognition of the contribution towards building the great nation for the last 3 assessment years. 7 scholars were registered their PhD and 16 scholars were completed their PhD under his guidance. Now, we want to express our sincere thanks for accepting our invitation and coming over to deliver the keynote address. Thank you, sir. Now the session is yours, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam, for your wonderful
interview. Thank you, sir. It's my pleasure.
Resource person.
It's my pleasure, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Next, I will request our principal in charge, Dr. R. Jagannath, to deliver a special address. Sir?
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, we are hearing you, sir. It is audible. It is audible. Sir, your voice is not audible, sir. Hello, sir.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, we are hearing you, sir. It is audible. It is audible.
Okay, okay. Respected Dr. Ludusamy sir, dear participants, dear IQC coordinator, RCC secretaries, and committee members, a warm welcome to all. At this outset, I would like to congratulate IQC coordinator and organizing team for conducting successful FDP 7 days program. From the first day onwards, we are receiving feedbacks from the participants. Based on that, we are very proud to say that we are very successfully conducting the 7-day FDP program. On first day itself, Dr. Bernardisamy sir delivered a lecture on curriculum aspect. On second day, Dr. S. Arivahan sir delivered a very wonderful presentation on research and extension. On third day, Dr. K. Karthikeyan sir gave a vivid picture about institution values and its best practices. On fourth day, Dr. Jacqueline Perinayam madam gave a clear-cut information about the student support and progressive. On fifth day, Dr. M. Selvakumar sir gave a strategic information about governance, leadership, and management. On sixth day, Dr. Ramani madam gave a detailed information about
good morning.
Infrastructure and
two minutes
last but not the least, because today our resource person going to deliver a talk on teaching, learning and evaluation. So Dr. Ludris, just before Manjula madam very beautifully introduced about our chief guest. Our chief guest is a versatile man. He has many experience in this field. He has been visiting various colleges as a resource person and a NAC mock visit he has visited. And moreover, he is excel in his own research for Graphically also. For example, I would like to say that in China, a research scholar has submitted a thesis entitled Dr. Indurdu Swami's conjecture in pebbles in graph theory. So this shows that his versatile knowledge in all the field, we are proud of him. And we are very fortunate to have all the resource person who is successful. Once again, I thank everybody for making this event more successful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, we shall move for a keynote address by Dr. A. Luther Sami, sir. Sir, the session is belongs to you, sir.
Okay, sir. Host can give me permission to share content.
Yes, sir. It is already given, sir.
But when I click share content, I don't see PPT.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is available to you, sir, now.
Okay. Do you see the slide?
No, sir. Till now, it is not visible, sir.
So I have given share. Only now it comes.
Yes, sir. It is coming, sir.
Recording is in progress. Okay. Do you get?
Yes.
Are you able to see the screen?
Yes, sir. It is visible. It is visible for us, sir.
What about audio?
Yes, sir. Audio is also clear, sir.
What about audio?
Audio is also clear, and your voice, your video is also visible, sir.
Also, okay. Okay, sir. Thank you very much for the nice introduction you have given about me and. Respected principal, respected officials of the college, respected IKC coordinator and IKC team, respected professors, greetings to one and all, good morning to one and all. India has one of the largest and diverse educational systems in the world. The 1964-66 Education Commission pointed out that the exercise of academic freedom by teachers is crucial for the development of intellectual climate in higher education institutions. Unless such a climate prevails, it is difficult to achieve the staff both of education. In raising the standard of education, Rajabalayam Raju's college has taken a good step forward in conducting this 7-day faculty development program on a revised accreditation framework of National Assessment and Accreditation Council. A paradigm shift for strategic enhancement of higher education in India. It's a good step forward, and I congratulate the IKC team who has taken this great step in raising the standard of education in higher educational institution. Dear professors, why do we need a framework for education at all? We need a framework for education because education has a certain objectives and purposes to be fulfilled. If you go through the NAC manual in the first 10 pages, you will see that NAC insists upon quality initiatives, these three important things. The primary focus of education should be to build disciplinary knowledge and skills, also generic knowledge, generic skills, then attitudes and values, so that there takes place an increase in learner competencies, there takes place increase in confidence of the graduates to face the competitive world. So taking the cognizance of the diversity in the kinds of higher educational institutions, higher educational institutions have been grouped in three categories. NAC has got these three categories: universities, autonomous colleges, affiliated and constituent colleges. And NAC has given three types of manuals. More or less, questions of universities and autonomous colleges will be almost the same, but for affiliated and constituent colleges, different set of questions are there. But in a sense, they are one and the same. Depending on the context, they have added some questions or deleted some questions for these categories. So you know, all of you know that the assessment process will be carried out in three stages. There are three components. One is preparing self-study report, SSR, and then after submitting self-study report, immediately after submitting self-study report, student satisfaction survey and the DVV process will begin. DVV data validation and verification process will begin. And the student satisfaction survey will also be initiated, will be conducted by NAC. At the end, after clearing DVV, after clearing a student satisfaction survey, then team visit will take place. And then after peer team visits the college, peer team will give its report. And if you see the self-study report and the manual, there will be 115 metrics for universities, 107 metrics for autonomous colleges, 93 metrics for UG affiliated college, 96 metrics for PG affiliated college. So in self-study report, there are two kinds of metrics, all that you would have heard. Just I am just recollecting what all you have heard. So quantifiable facts and figures as data, if you can give, they are grouped, they are given under the quantitative metrics. So quantitative metrics QNM and QLM, there are two different kinds of metrics classified by the National Assessment and Accreditation Council. And if you look at the key indicators, then qualitative metrics, quantitative metrics for universities, for all categories, there are only 7 criteria. And then for universities, there are 34 key indicators. For autonomous colleges, also 34 key indicators. Whereas for UG affiliated college, 31 key indicators are there. For PG affiliated college, 32 indicators are there. If you look at quality metrics, 36 quality metrics are there for universities, 35 for autonomous and UG affiliated colleges, 36 qualitative metrics are there for PG affiliated colleges. Whereas coming to QNM, there are 79 quantitative QNM, quantitative metrics. Oh, has tremendously reduced the number of metrics, both in qualitative and quantitative, for colleges coming for assessment and accreditation process. Earlier, when we went for accreditation, that is last year, the peer team visit took place in August 26 and 27, 2019. When we prepared a self-study report, we had altogether 136 metrics, 98 QLM, 36, 38 QLM. Now there is a tremendous decrease in size, in number of metrics. For autonomous colleges, only 107, whereas for UG affiliated college, only 93 metrics, 93%, and then for PG affiliated colleges, only 96 metrics. The National Assessment and Accreditation Council has fixed. And if you all this you have already seen for curricular aspects, 100 marks for UG PG affiliated college, 150 marks for autonomous and universities institutions. Now the main discussion is on the second criterion. So in the second criterion, we have seven key indicators. In first key indicator is student enrollment and profile. For autonomous, the student enrollment and profile for autonomous institutions. So these are the score given. Okay. For second criterion, for autonomous colleges, for teaching, learning, and evaluation, only 30 points are given, 30 marks, whereas for UG as well as for PG affiliated colleges, 350 marks are given. So this 2.1 student enrollment and profile gets 40-40. I'm talking about affiliated colleges. For autonomous college, it's here, second column gives the score, the weightage for the autonomous colleges totaling 300, whereas for university only 200. So affiliated colleges get more score in teaching, learning, and evaluation. So it is very, very important from assessment point of view. We'll now look at each key indicator one by one, and the different metrics associated with each key indicator. So if we take student enrollment, so here for teaching, learning, and evaluation, I have already told you that for autonomous college, 300 marks are given, whereas for affiliated college, 350 marks are allotted. In the first key indicator, 2.1, student enrollment and profile, for autonomous college, only 20 marks are given, whereas affiliated college gets 40 marks. We have to give the profile. So if you look at the first question, average enrollment percentage we have to give. So first of all, we have to give for each year number of students admitted, number of sanctioned seats, and then what are the documents we have to produce. So I think in previous talks you would have heard about the data templates. All QNM questions will have data templates. And then in data templates, wherever you get a formula like this, this denominator, total number of sanctioned seats, this will be, this we would have given as input in the extended profile of the institution. In the extended profile of the institution, all these denominators we have fed. And all these calculations, if you want, you can perform this calculation and you can see for yourself the score which you get or the response which you get. All these computations are automated. NAC will automatically, that is NAC software will calculate this percentage for each year. So we have to provide a number of students admitted in one particular academic year, and then a number of sanctioned seats like that for 5 years. We will give the data, and then this computation percentage per year will be calculated by NAC software. Also this one, average percentage for all the 5 years, that will also be computed by NAC software. So what is the data we have? So when we prepare a self-study report, there should not be any contradiction, since especially the denominators which we give in case of numeric, that is quantitative metrics, they are very, very important. If there are going to be some disagreement, then in DVB, number of questions the higher education institutions will get. So this is the first question. Autonomous college get, 10 marks is allotted, whereas affiliated and constituent colleges, they have got 20 marks here. And then going to the, this is the calculation. This calculation will be done by NAC software. So student enrollment, that is the first question. And then second question, a number of total students admitted in reserved categories. So this denominator, this will also be available in extended profile of the institution. So here, number of students admitted from the reserved categories and number of seats fixed by government for reserved category. So that for each year we have to provide, and then the average percentage will be computed by the NAC automated software. So autonomous college gets 10 marks here, affiliated college will get 20 marks. So with this first key indicator is over. So moving to the second key indicator, 2.2, catering to student diversity. For student diversity, autonomous college is given only 30 marks, whereas the affiliated college or constituent college gets 50 points. So the first, very first question, the institution assesses the learning levels of the students and organizes special programs for advanced learners and slow learners. Remember, affiliated college gets 30 marks for this question. Though, see here, we will give in NAC template, we have to give the response in 500 words, but then the supporting documents, see file description, you have to link explaining all that you have given in the abstract form. So when you write a paper, in the beginning, after giving the author, name of the author, author's affiliation, we will give abstract of the entire paper. Like that, for the entire report, we have to prepare the abstract, and the abstract must be written in 500 words. So all other details must be given in the form of documents, all that you can upload, whatever is possible, you can upload in the college website. See, the college website is the face of the institution. All that that happens in the institution with regard to teaching, learning process, with regard to any event, any academic event in the institution, you have to prepare the report. And what then every day you should keep updating the website. So you have to paste link, and any type of additional information you can prepare here. So supporting your claim, you have to give the number of activities you are preparing for, you are conducting for advanced learners and the slow learners. Here, this question expects that the higher educational institution, first of all, conducts a diagnostic test at the entry of the graduates. That is when they, starting the academic year, the new students, they must be given a diagnostic test at the beginning. In our college, the English department, especially English department, all departments will be doing this, especially English department is conducting diagnostic test. We are conducting bridge course, and then at the end of the bridge course, we are conducting diagnostic test, and we are classifying students into stream A, stream B, stream C. For each stream, we have different content to be taught. Similarly, if you take major subjects, some departments conduct the diagnostic test at the beginning of the academic year, some departments they conduct after teach diagnostic test, and then they get to know who are the students who can pick up fast, who are slow learners, and accordingly we conduct remedial coaching and for advanced learners. A number of opportunities are given. They are given chances to conduct, to deliver lectures. They present papers to their student, to the students of the college, and they are also sent outside to present papers and participate in different activities. And different types of programs. You can plan for this. So assessing the learning level of students and organizing special learning, you have to support key indicator student full-time teacher ratio. And sometimes earlier they used the word current academic year. Now there was a confusion, and therefore they have given like this data for the latest completed academic year. I think you understand the meaning of this phrase, data for the latest completed academic year. So for each, if you are submitting your report, say in August 2020, that means for 1920, you have to provide the data. For the previous academic year, completed academic year, you have to give the data. So this is the mark distribution for autonomous and affiliated colleges. So moving to the third key indicator, teaching learning process. So this is the life of the institution, teaching learning process. Of course, the entire person, first we looked at the profile of the that is student profile, and then student diversity. So after having known student profile and then student diversity, how are we going to design the teaching learning process? Then comes the key indicator, teacher profile and quality. So what quality do we have? What quality the teachers of the institutions have? So like that, the degree is going up for different key indicators. So coming to the third key indicator, that is teaching learning process. This is the life of any institution. So whether it is autonomous college or affiliated college, they are treated equally. They get 50 marks here. And so here, we need to know certain things. These are all available in NAC manual also. You have to begin with end in mind. What do we mean by that? We have to fix the outcomes the graduates should possess at the end of the course, that is course outcome, then program specific outcome. So that means pertaining to that specific department, program outcomes, that is institutional level program outcomes. So here, there are the starting point for all curriculum design. This is something to do with the first criterion, but then without first criterion, we don't have the second criterion. So the starting point for all curriculum design must be a clear definition of significant learning that students are to achieve by the end of formal education. So we have to identify the needs, the desirable graduate attributes to meet the needs of the industry and society. Identification of outcomes. We have to formulate a set of program outcomes in congruence with the needs of industry and society that specify knowledge, skills, and attributes program graduates should have. So formulating desired outcomes a student need to achieve is very, very important. So we have to set the goals for the entire program in terms of a program educational objective. You would also hear the terminology called PEO. So the autonomous college, they will design curriculum, whereas affiliated college, they may not design, but they have to implement the curriculum given by the university. So curriculum design and development is done by Autonomous College, where curriculum implementation is done by the affiliated college. And even affiliated colleges, given the syllabus by the university, given the syllabus by the universities, even the affiliated college, you have to fix the program educational objective, program outcomes, program specific outcomes, course outcomes. So take the syllabus of each paper, you fix course outcomes. So what are course outcomes? Course outcomes are statements that describe significant and essential learning that learners have achieved and can reliably demonstrate at the end of a course. Similarly, if you take program-specific outcomes, program-specific outcomes are statements that students which will signify what the students should be able to do at the time of graduation with reference to that specific discipline. Whereas program outcomes, they are statements that describe what students are expected to be able to do by the time of graduation. See, at the course level, we have to fix course outcomes. At the department level, we have to fix the program specific outcomes. At the institution level, we have to fix program outcomes. So they need to be formulated for UG, PG, MPhil separately. And these learning outcomes encompass what students should know and understand, what students should be able to do, what students should become at the end of the course, what qualities, what outcome, what capabilities a student would have achieved at the end of the course. So they are course outcomes. What capabilities they would have achieved from department point of view, that is program specific outcome. From institution point of view, what outcomes students would have achieved, that is program outcomes. You would have also heard about another terminology called program educational objective, or they are also given in a number of institutions in terms of vision, mission statements. So vision, mission statements, more general statements. So you just come down a little bit, you can set forth program educational objectives, and then you can still you can make some concrete statements which will give the capability of the graduate, that is program outcome and program specific outcomes, and then course outcomes. So there are an array of courses. I mean, there is an array of courses, number of courses. I think by this time you know all these terminologies. Course means it is a paper. Program means it is BSc Maths, it is a program. MSc Maths, it is a program. MSc Physics, it is a program. So for each program, there is an array of courses, and therefore array of courses have course outcomes. And then at the institutional level, at the department level, we have written a set of statements signifying significant learning the graduates would be possessing at the end of the program. So program specific outcomes and program outcomes and the course outcomes, they are related. So through an array of courses, with all these, we have to create educational experience. So first of all, we have to look at the type of students to whom we are going to teach. That's why we are looking at student profile and student diversity and so on. And then what profile, what quality our teachers have, teacher profile and quality. And if you go to third criterion, promotion of research and facilities, resource mobilization for research, and then innovation ecosystem, research publication and awards. And if you move to the fifth criterion, you have student support activities, student support in terms of financial also, scholarship given by the government, the scholarship provided by the management, and then student support activities, student participation, and number of capability enhancement activities students should experience in the educational institution, and then catering to student diversity teaching learning process all through all these. So do we have a good teaching learning process, we have to get satisfaction report or feedback report from the students themselves, that is student satisfaction survey. Also to get to know the industry's needs, we have to have consultancy and collaboration with a number of industries and institutions. So with these, we should be able to create a good educational experience. So the good educational experience that we create should enable our students to achieve program specific outcomes or program outcomes or course outcomes that they are fixed at the beginning of the course. So that's why we say we have to begin with the end in mind. So we have to fix the outcomes. Without outcomes, we should not proceed. So in fixing, so we have to facilitate the creation of a learner-centric environment which is conducive for quality education. So we have to map outcomes through curriculum. So they are also the institutions how to fix once outcomes are determined, they will influence all the components of the curriculum. They teach affiliated college, but then there also you have to assess a student outcome. You can assess to a certain extent, and then university will conduct examinations, university examinations, and assess the performance of the students. So outcomes define scope and structure of the content and the educational experience that we create, through which students will develop knowledge, skill, and attitudes defined by the outcomes. So the philosophy of education of the institution that is given by in terms of vision and mission, and that can be further explained through the terminology called the program, educational objective, and then through vision, mission, and program, educational objective. They are all more generic statements, whereas focusing all these vision, mission, and the program, educational objectives of the institution or the philosophy of the institution, we have to set forth the program, educational outcomes, program specific outcomes, course outcomes. So these are some concrete statements, whereas these are all generic statements. Vision, mission, and program educational objective, they are all generic in nature. Whereas in concrete terms, in fact, you would have heard about Bloom's taxonomy. Bloom's taxonomy was given in the year 1956 itself, and then in 2003, the Bloom's taxonomy was revised. So in Bloom's taxonomy, you have all these action verbs. We call them action verbs. So through Bloom's taxonomy's action verbs, we have to fix course outcomes, program specific outcomes, program outcomes. So these outcomes will guide curriculum design and curriculum delivery. So for autonomous college, both will take place, curriculum design and delivery. For affiliated college, curriculum delivery will take place. If you go through the manual, for affiliated question, the first question 1.1.1 is that does the institution deliver the content through well-documented process? And for autonomous institution, first question, yes, this is the first question. The first question is the curricula developed and implemented have relevance to the local, national, regional, and global developmental needs, which is reflected in program outcomes, program specific or affiliated college. How effective you are in delivering the curriculum. So in order to be effective in delivering the curriculum or the syllabus or the content given by the university, you have to set forth the course outcomes, you have to set forth the program specific outcomes, you have to set forth the program outcomes. So these outcomes only guide curriculum design or curriculum and delivery, and the curriculum delivery, teaching, learning, and assessment. So the next step in facilitating the creation of learner-centric environment conducive for quality education is that we have to design aligned teaching learning process. So outcomes must dictate the teaching learning process. Of course, IKC will be there to facilitate the institution to assess the learning levels of students and departments in order that you can organize special programs for advanced learners and slow learners. And in a teaching learning process, you have to use student-centric methods. There are a number of student-centric methods, experiential learning, participative learning, problem-solving methodologies. So whatever method will facilitate students to learn in a better way, you have to follow. And then you have to also prepare and adhere to the academic calendar and teaching plan. Academic calendar institution will prepare, and academic calendar must also be prepared by each course teacher. You will call it a teaching plan. So we have to also carry out a number of capacity enhancement and the skill development activities so that the students develop their, improve their capability, because it's a highly competitive world. That's why it's not mere transferring knowledge is expected of any higher educational institution. Together with the knowledge, we have to impart the skills needed for graduates to face the world. The attitudes, that is very, very important. What is the attitude? What is the value we inculcate in the minds of students? That is very, very important. So students should also be benefited by guidance for competitive examination and career counseling offered by the institution. All this you will find in the next manual. So in coming to the individual teacher, institution will prepare academic calendar, handbook, whatever you name you give for that. But for each paper, the teacher must prepare a teaching plan. So for a teacher, for a course, for an hour, given the paper for that hour, can you say which concept you are going to teach? Can you say which program outcome or program specific outcome or course outcome is addressed? So, Ramur also is requesting to annotate the content. During annotation, you cannot control the shared content until you stop annotating. So cognitive level, which cognitive level? I think you should have heard about six levels of six cognitive levels. When we talk about Bloom's taxonomy, there are six levels and of knowledge. Knowledge level one, K1 to K6. K1, remember, just reproducing. Then K2, understand. Remember, understand. K2, understand. K3, apply. Then K4, analyze. K5, evaluate. K6, create. So first three, they are called lower cognitive level. Then four, five, six, that is analyze, create, and evaluate and create, they are called the higher cognitive level. When we frame question also, when we frame questions, whether it is affiliated college or autonomous college, when you frame questions for class test or continuous internal assessment test, you have to look at the cognitive level which you are testing in the minds of students. You have to fix, lower order level questions should not exceed 40%. Only less than 40% of questions should address lower cognitive level. That means 60% of questions should address a higher cognitive level. That means K4, K5, K6. K4 is analyze, and then K5, evaluate, K6, create. So for a teacher, for a course, for another, which concept are you going to teach? You have to put forth all these well ahead before starting the semester, at the beginning of the semester. Now you have plenty of time. You take the paper which you are going to teach to your students, you prepare a teaching plan, and you say which concept you are going to teach, which course outcome you are going to address. For each course, for each paper, you have to fix a minimum five course outcomes. Of course, so you have to use, for each cognitive level, there are action verbs. Action verbs you have to follow in fixing the course outcomes, program specific outcomes, program outcomes. So which cognitive level you are addressing, and then which teaching method you are going to use. So there are number of teaching methods, and then which teaching tool are you going to use. All that you have to put in black and white, so that you get a good teaching plan. And then you have to adhere to the teaching plan. That's a question you see here. So preparation and adherence to the academic calendar and teaching plan. So by the institution, that means don't think that institution will give the teaching plan. Only the course teacher has to prepare the teaching plan. So each course teacher prepares teaching plan for his or her own paper, and then for all the papers we will have teaching plans, and then the institution in general we will have an academic calendar. That's all. Marking A order and so on, which activity is going to be connected, which event is going to take place. So all that institution will prepare. So this is very, very important. This is what we call the aligned teaching learning process. Which outcome are we aiming at? Which course outcome we are going to address in particular hour? All that we ought to fix. So preparing the teaching plan is very, very important process. If you can prepare a good teaching plan, that will dictate all your
Excuse me, sir. Sir. Excuse me, sir. I'm audible to you.
Yes, you are audible to me. Sir, please ask our Ludo Sam sir to come in line, because his voice is not audible. Vishnu, can you hear me? Vishnu?
Yes, we are coming, sir. We will call.
Okay. Call the resource person to come in online.
Unmuted. Do you hear? Now it's working, huh?
Yes, sir. Sir, we are hearing. It is working.
Okay. We'll proceed. So preparation and adherence of academic calendar and preparing the teaching plan of each course teacher is very, very important. So we'll be prepare a teaching plan. We will fix for which concept experiential learning we are going to follow, for which concept we are going to use participative learning method, for which concept we are going to use problem solving method. So the teaching method itself has to be fixed at the beginning of the academic year or at the beginning of the semester. So for this following student-centric methods, autonomous college gets 15 marks, affiliated college gets 20 marks. The teachers using ICT-enabled tools, including online resources for effective teaching and learning process. See, if you look at the NAAC manual clearly demands that teachers use varied teaching methodologies, varied tools in order that we create a rich teaching learning experience. So today's children are born in digital age. Human societies have seen four ages, starting from hunting age. So the first age is called the hunting age, second age agricultural age, third age is called industrial age, fourth one is called information age or digital age. So digital age has begun in 1970s when the invention of computers took place, but then those days it was not very much prevalent. But nowadays, children born nowadays, they born with digital background. Always in their hands they have digital gadgets. Because of gadgets we cannot see anybody, so everyone has digital gadgets. So that is one question in the NAAC manual. Teachers use ICT enabled tools. So going to ICT enabled tools, you have a number of platforms. I would point out a number of platforms that you can use. See, creating learning materials using digital technology in order to adopt technology for teaching learning processes is expected of us. So today's children, they are digital natives, born during or after the digital age, always attached to a phone or other device, intuitive learners, multitasking is there, rapidly switching over to different tasks, extremely they are social, multimedia oriented, whereas some of us teachers, we are digital immigrants. Some teachers may be digital natives, but then most of us are digital immigrants, adopters of the web technology. So we prefer to talk in person. We are logical learners. We focus on one task at a time. We prefer to have interaction with one or few people rather than many. We get information from traditional news sites and in particular from printed material. So if you look at there are a number of digital platforms to create teaching learning materials using technology. Google Class, that is a very famous one. Apart from Google Class, a number of digital platforms are available there. Concept Map, Screencasting, EdTech, Poll, Edmodo, Book Creator, Canvas, Socrative, Project, Think, Class Dojo, EduClipper, Storybird, Mimoto, Kahoot, Easily, Yorkster, Google Sites, Google Tour, Builder, Fan Academy, Manga High, Meme Generator, Pencil Code, Picto Chart, Picton Comics, Sutan, Bukaro, Wix, Backlit, YouTube Playlist, Google Trends, MindMeister, Mind Map, Newsela, Set Simulations, Storyboards, Study Stack, Timeline, WhatsApp with Culture, Tinkercad Learning Center. So these are different platforms. Some platforms you have to purchase. 90% or 80% platforms are free only. So we have to train, periodical training must be there to implement the appropriate technology tools for developing learning materials. As Dr. Thomas said, knowledge is a tool, and like all tools, its impact is in the hands of the user. We have to use, there are plenty of platforms, knowledge tools. We have to make use of all of them. So if you look at the study released by McGraw-Hill Education in partnership with the Hanover Research, they interviewed the 3,000 students. These 3,000 students voiced their digital preferences in college education. They said, they say 81% of students say digital learning technology is helping them to boost their grades. So we don't say this is the only method or only through we can teach. There are other better methods, but then present day students expect that they are given the digital materials, digital preferences they have given. So this is a variety to which students will get a lot of interest in learning. So these 3,000 students, out of 3,000 students survey, 81% of the students have said digital learning technology is helping them to boost their grades. So that's why there is a question, ICT-enabled tools. How many teachers use ICT-enabled tools? So you have to train all teachers. So when you prepare a self-study report, you should claim that all teachers use ICT-enabled tools. And you, the NAC will ask for learning management, some user-ID and password. You should be in a position to give a user-ID and password of learning management system the institution has created. So don't simply say PPT you have prepared. No, PPT is not sufficient to say that your teachers are using ICT-enabled tools. So a number of digital platforms are there, and the learning management system must be created. So coming to the third question, in the third indicator of the second criterion, so ratio of students to mentor for academic and other related issues. We have in our institution age-old counseling system. In the age-old counseling system, under counselors, in each department, there are mentors. Each mentor will have around 10 students. So that is the ratio they are asking for. So for each mentor, how many students do we allocate? In that case, what is the allocation order? Surplus pertaining to assigning mentors to mentees. Mentor-mentee ratio, that's what they are asking here. And see, through Rajabalayam or Tinnavelly, they are almost in the plain shadow region, I hope. So all the western guards will block all rain, and it's rain shadow region of poor rural settlements. Are in and around your institutions, of how far we help students, we mentor students in order that they grow academically, and even some psychological problems we are able to solve it. And it's a powerful mechanism that we are practicing in our institution, and your institution can also explore ways and means of improving the mentor-mentee system. So here, each mentor is assigned with 10 students, and there will be official meeting times and unofficial friendly meeting times. So whether it is unofficial meeting time or official meeting time, the tutor, the mentor will have interaction with the mentees, and then they'll be getting to know their problems. It may be psychological problems or academic problems or other financial problems. If students have financial problems, the mentor will speak to, will direct the student to the counselor. Counselor then will speak to the individual student. If the individual student is in financial crisis for carrying out his studies, he will be referred to the institution and the institution heads. And if the student doesn't get any financial assistance from the government, he will be given management scholarship. So like that, also psychologically, we have started a number of cases, and the students have been benefited. So this we have been practicing it for a long time. So there is a professional counselor. There are two professional counselors, and the two professional counselors for each department, each staff is given 10 students. So that way we are able to sort out academic and other related issues, and we help students to learn principally. So this is a very, very important. The affiliated college of other system gets 15 marks. So going to the next key indicator, teacher profile and quality. For this key indicator, autonomous college gets only 50 marks, whereas affiliated college gets 60 marks. So average percentage of full-time teachers, again, sanctioned the post during the last 5 years. When you prepare self-study report, this is the question. It's a Q&A question. Question will be there. For each year, you will fill the data. And then you have to say, whenever you get quantitative question, there will be a thing called data template. Data template, they will be given in Excel format. In the manual, in section B, all data templates are given. Whereas when you are going to fill self-study report, in the manual they are given so that you prepare your report, the full report, before feeding all the report in NAC portal. So when you feed the report in NAC portal, you will be given Excel sheets. In Excel sheets, you have to fill all the details. And even for a quantitative question, sometimes you have to upload the supporting documents, the evidence for the conduct of certain events. So for all, both for quantitative and qualitative metrics, you have to prepare evidences, you have to prepare supporting documents. So percentage per year, number of full-time teachers divided by number of sanctioned posts multiplied by 100, so you get average percentage. The affiliated college gets 20 points for this question, whereas autonomous college gets only 15. So average percentage of 242, average percentage of full-time teachers with the PhD. So if there are more PhD, so institutions should see that your teachers have got a PhD. Otherwise, you have to instruct your teachers to get the PhD. So for this, both for autonomous and affiliated colleges, you have 20 points. If there are teachers without a PhD, you instruct them to take a PhD immediately, because you get more marks for this question. So we hear that teachers, they are more important, because we have a qualified or good quality of teachers. Good quality of teachers that determines the performance of the institution. So that is very, very important. So average teaching experience, for that also we are given. So what is the stability of teachers? So sum of total experience of full-time teachers in the same institution divided by number of full-time teachers. In the same institution, the teachers should have got divided by number of full-time teachers. So that average is calculated. So this is the mark distribution for affiliated college 20, here 5 more points, whereas for autonomous college 15 points. So moving to the next key indicator, fifth key indicator, and the second criterion, 2.5, evaluation process and reforms. Here, for autonomous college, more marks is given, because it's a real evaluation process we are carrying out, whereas for affiliated colleges, a certain portion is evaluated by university, and then some continuation final assessment or class test to enforce, to see that the students have actually learned what we have taught, we will conduct class test. So even in class test, you have to use proper methodology in framing the questions. So that process is being tested here. So if we go to the autonomous college manual, for this question, 20 marks are given. So number of days from the date of end of examination and till the declaration of results. So for each year we have to give, and there is a formula in Excel sheet also we have to give the data, and then finally we have to give the average. And If we are able to publish the result, say in 15 days, we will get the score. Otherwise, for this question, score will go down. So for affiliated college, the mechanism of internal assessment is transparent and robust in terms of frequency and mode. So that evaluation, that examination process, we have to be very clear, and for that affiliated college gets 15 marks, whereas autonomous college gets 20. So moving to the next question, 2.5.2, average percentage of student complaints or grievances about evaluation against total number appeared in the examinations. So this is for autonomous college 15 points, whereas for affiliated college 15 marks. Mechanism to deal with the internal and external examination related grievances. If at all there is a grievance, it must be thrashed out, it must be examined, the students must be helped. So there must be a transparent mechanism, time-bound mechanism, and efficient mechanism. So what mechanism do we follow? That should be described in 500 words and the supporting documents, all that you can produce. So for affiliated colleges, only these two questions are there. Coming to the autonomous college, there is another question, IT integration and reforms in the examination purposes and process, including CIA, and they have got considerable improvement in examination management system. So examination manual, the autonomous college has to pick that. In the examination manual, how questions are framed, all that you can explain. So what Bloom's level is being checked, what course outcome is addressed, what program outcome is tested, all that. See, program outcome, program specific outcome, course outcome. So you have to frame at the beginning, and then in the teaching learning process it should be there, and then in assessment also you should implement that. That's why we call it aligned teaching learning and assessment procedure we have to follow. So here there is no question class 1 to 2, 5, 3 for affiliated colleges, only for autonomous schools 15 marks, because the autonomous colleges have more component, more score here. So that is the evaluation process and reforms, and then another important thing to get with is student performance and learning outcomes. So student performance is tested through all our examinations. For affiliated colleges, some portion is being tested by university and some portion is being tested by the concerned college. So here, for autonomous college, only 50 marks are given, whereas for affiliated college, 60 marks are given for this key indicator. So in student performance and learning outcomes, a number of things we have to do. As we have already pointed out in criterion one, for autonomous college, you have to design your content. For affiliated college, you have to design the teaching and delivery process. So then you have to implement that teaching learning process. Actual teaching learning process will take place. And then when you come to the assessment, in assessment, a number of steps are involved there. So what we discussed earlier is given here, 261, but it should be done even for in the first criterion itself. Program outcomes, course outcomes for all programs offered by the institution are stated and displayed on the website. So what we do is we display in our website, we have printed all them and we have given for all teachers and for all students. Together with the syllabus, we print course outcomes, program specific outcomes, program outcomes, all that we distribute to all stakeholders, direct stakeholders. Who are direct stakeholders? Students and teachers. So we give. And we have also published, we have also posted in our website, anybody can. So 20 marks are given for autonomous colleges, 15 for affiliated colleges. So even affiliated colleges, they should frame course outcomes, should frame program specific outcomes, they should frame program outcome. So this is 261. And so for framing course outcomes, program specific outcomes, program outcomes, we have to use Bloom's taxonomy. The two Bloom's, revised Bloom's taxonomy are there. They are given six levels, K1, remember, K2, understand, K3, apply, K4 analyze, K5 evaluate, K6 create. For each level, for each cognitive level, for each understanding level, for each cognitive level, there are action verbs. Using action verbs, you have to fix course outcomes. So six course outcomes. Program specific outcomes, how many program specific outcomes you can fix? You can fix from say 8 to 10. So as I have already told you, program specific outcomes are fixed by the entire department when the graduates go out of the institution at the program level. What are the qualities the students would have achieved? So program specific outcomes 8 to 10 you can fix. Also at the institutional level, say 6 to 8 you can fix, or 8 to 10 maximum. So 10 plus 10 maximum 20, or 8 plus 8 16 can be there. Program outcome 8, that is at the institutional level. Program specific outcome at the department level 8. So 8 plus 8 16. Whereas for each course at least the 6 outcomes must be there, and for each course outcome, and you have to also fix the cognitive level, so the increasing order of difficulty. So you should not say when the paper has the course has 5 units, you should not say for each unit you are fixing the course outcome. Not like that. You can fix one course outcome, so that course outcome can be there in all 5 units. So in the increasing level of cognitive level, you can order the course outcomes. So course outcomes, program specific outcomes, program outcomes, all that we have to fix. So that's what 262 says. And then here, after fixing that, do we have any measurement method for the attainment of outcomes, program outcomes, program specific outcomes, course outcomes? So you give the general procedure in 500 words, but then all details. It's an enormous process. It is a Himalayan task, in fact. Of course, softwares are available under the different companies. They come forward to supply softwares or methods. But then if we have our own team, it will be better each and every time. If we are going to buy software from companies outside the institution, every time we have to call the company, every time we have to pay them, it will be a tedious process. Customizing is difficult, whereas here if we have our own team, we can take care of our website, updating website, preparing report, and doing the attainment work and so on and so forth, we can take. So if you are going to look at the attainment of program outcomes, program specific outcomes and course outcomes, so they are done in 3 different levels. You will come to that 3 different levels. Before that, there is one question here in the next. Pass percentage. For autonomous, okay. A 20-mark system of institutions, 20 marks. Whereas for affiliated system, 50 marks. So getting good pass percentage. So if we decide to plan and going to create a teaching learning process in an aligned way, if we have aligned teaching learning process to attain the outcomes, so then definitely pass percentage will be. When you have more pass percentage, autonomous institutions get 20 points, whereas affiliated institutions get 30 points. Okay, so coming to the attainment, for each year you have to give the result.
Excuse me.
You can instruct participants to stop unnecessary. Okay, shall I proceed? Hello? Okay, I'll proceed. So, getting the pass percentage is very, very important from autonomous college point of view. Those colleges which have a low pass percentage will get low score only, because 20 marks are given for autonomous college and 30 marks are given for affiliated college. For each year, we have to get the percentage and then average percentage. So if we have good percentage of result, these 30 and 20 marks, we'll get a good score. So coming to the assessing the attainment of outcomes, and there are evaluation process, there are a number of things that contribute to the assessment of attainment of outcomes. So this also will speak about the attainment of outcome, number of students qualifying in state, national and international examination, number of student progression to higher education, number of students placed, all that. So all these come under the assessing the attainment of outcome. Of course, what quality we have, what attitude we have imbibed in students' minds, what values we have inculcated. So quality and quantity of extension activities, institutional and social, institutional values and social responsibilities, all that counts in assessing the attainment of outcomes. So here we have an array of courses. So number of course outcomes are there. They collectively achieve program specific outcomes and the program outcomes. So how do we measure CO attainment? How do we connect them with the attainment of POs? It's a big theory. You need to have a 2 to 3 day workshop for formulating course outcomes, program specific outcomes, program outcomes, and then the alignment and so on, mapping and so on, then the attainment calculation. It's a big process. Of course, if you look at seventh criterion in 7.2, you have best practices of the institution, and IKC can get the best practices of the different departments also. So the institutional distinctiveness. So this is once again the outcome. What outcome as the institution we have. So that will be given in 7.2 and 7.2. So for all that, NAC is giving score. So in assessing the attainment of outcomes, we have three types: curriculum attainment, mapping competency and the performance indicator, and then attainment of CO, PSO, PO. So we are put together here. So going to the first one, curriculum attainment. So effective curriculum delivery through a well-planned and documented process involving all aspects, whether it is autonomous college or affiliated college, we have to effectively deliver our curriculum through a well planned and documented. Only for that, I said each course teacher before entering into the class should have prepared the teaching plan, so curriculum attainment. So you can, if you want to, before bringing the course outcomes, so for each unit we can bring outcomes, but then for each course you have to bring only 6 outcomes. Though I have put a unit outcomes, for each unit we are not giving outcomes. After putting all outcomes of different units, and then you categorize, you fix 6 outcomes for each course, and then you have to use Bloom's taxonomy, and what is the gap you are going to have, all that in the attainment you can calculate a gap analysis, all that. So that is curriculum attainment. And then you have to map competencies and the performance indicators. So when you fix a program specific outcome and program outcome, you have to fix the competency. Competency, how are you going to fix a competency through performance indicators. So what are performance indicators? They are measuring tools. They are measuring tools. So what is that you are going to see? Performance indicators you can get even you have a consultancy with the industry. So industry will tell you what indicator they have in recruiting the graduates. So accordingly you got to fix the performance indicator. Here in India, only a few institutions engage in consultancy. In foreign countries, a number of institutions have consultancies. So through consultancy, performance indicators can be fixed. Here in India, since institutions lack collaborative activities with industries and the institutes, we can go in for Bloom's taxonomy, and from that we can get performance indicators. So for each program outcome, for each course outcome, we have to fix the performance indicator. So defining competency levels as per examination form. So we have to fix the examination system or test system or classical system or a continuous internal assessment system and so on. So defining performance indicators for each competency level. So we have to map performance indicators with the questions and analysis. Each question must be associated with the performance indicator. I told you that for each program, we have program outcome, program specific outcome. So program outcome and program specific outcome must be explained through performance indicators. So what performance indicators and which competency you are aiming at, that's what you are fixing here. So performance indicators, they are explicit statements of expectations of student learning. They can act as measuring tools in assessment to understand the extent of attainment of outcome. So competency, so every program specific outcome and the program outcome should imply different ability to be attained by the level. So that is the competency. So that is the second type of assessing the attainment of outcomes. The third one, course outcome and PO, PSO attainment. So you we have to identify the extent of compliance of university curriculum for attaining PO's and PSO's, question paper validation to ensure desired standard from outcome attainment perspective as well as learning levels perspective. Mapping of questions, this is very, very important to map. Mapping of questions with the course outcome, which course outcome is being tested through that question, you have to fix in the question paper pattern. After giving the question, you have to say which course outcome is tested there, which program specific outcome and which program outcome is fixed there, which cognitive level is tested there. I told you about six cognitive levels. So which cognitive level of knowledge is being tested in that particular question. So all that you have to fix. Then so in attainment, there are two types, direct and indirect attainment. So direct, what is direct attainment? It may be class test or it may be university examination. It may be a semester examination, examination conducted by the autonomous college. So that is direct. You may conduct, teacher may conduct this program, a teacher may give the assignment. So all that direct. What is indirect? Course end survey, this indirect attainment method. Program end survey, at the end of the program, before students are going out, you can give a questionnaire and you can get the feedback how what benefit they had out of this program which they have undergone. So all that so program end survey, course end survey, they are indirect. Program end survey, alumni survey. The alumni after getting graduation here, they'll be working somewhere. Suppose 2020 May some students have passed out and 2021 academic year they are working somewhere. So 2022 academic year they are working somewhere. You can call those recent alumni or alumna. And you can give a questionnaire how far they have achieved course outcomes, program specific outcomes, program outcomes, how far they have achieved, how far they are helpful in their career, in workplace, how far these outcomes help. So you get from them feedback. Accordingly, you fine tune your course outcomes, program specific outcomes, and the program outcomes. So through feedback, you get attainment. So that is called indirect attainment. So through direct, through indirect. So for direct attainment, you can have some proportion. For indirect attainment, you can have some proportion. In that way, you can finally arrive at the calculation of attainment of course outcomes, program specific outcomes, program outcomes. So all this we have to carry out. Then the seventh criterion, one other important key indicator is student satisfaction survey. For this student satisfaction survey, we have to upload the details of all students currently studying in the campus, and then to 30% of students, NAC will send a questionnaire. The questionnaire is already given in the NAC website. There are 20 objective type questions, one descriptive type questions. For 20 objective type questions, all these questions are related to refer to only teaching learning. So teaching, that's why student satisfaction survey with regard to only teaching learning. For all other aspects, you can conduct different types of feedback mechanism. You can conduct and you can get feedback. what the teaching learning NAC is getting straight away from students. So every year IPC can conduct this student satisfaction survey, and you can train your students. Student email ID should be given, and NAC will communicate to students through their email ID. So 30% of students questionnaire will be sent to NAC, will be sent by NAC, whereas if 10% of students are going to respond to the questionnaire sent by NAC, this key indicator will get marked. If 9.9% of students only have given responses for the student satisfaction survey questionnaire given by NAC, then autonomous college will lose 50 marks. Affiliated college will lose 60 marks. So out of 30% sent by NAC, at least 10% of students should have participated in student satisfaction survey. So as soon as the higher education institutions have submitted the self-study report in NAC portal, this will start, this process will begin. So in advance, you have to instruct students to check their mail regularly. Before you submit the self-study report, the students must be given the instruction that they must check their mail every day so that they respond to the questionnaire. So online student satisfaction survey, all these details you have to give, and it will be conducted by NAC. So apart from that, I think IQAC will conduct feedback for autonomous colleges, for syllabus building. Even affiliate colleges, you can get feedback, and you can send to the university so that when university revises syllabus, they can incorporate all the suggestions put by you. You have to give action taken. So analyze the feedback, you prepare action taken report. If it is autonomous college, you can keep it and you can take for your course correction. Whereas if it is affiliated college, you send it to the university saying that this is the feedback we have received with regard to the syllabus from students, teachers, employees, alumni, parents, and so on. So general feedback, infrastructure, availability, teaching, and attendance, and so on and so forth. For all that, you have to collect the feedback, analyze, prepare action taken report, and the action taken report should be sent to the proper unit so that action is initiated. So feedback, if you can upload in the website, it will be a good thing. So student satisfaction survey, every year IPC can conduct. Student feedback on teachers, you can conduct. The performance appraisal for faculty and for non-teaching faculty, for non-teaching staff, you can conduct. And the performance appraisal faculty may contain these types of components: self-appraisal, peer appraisal, head of the department appraisal, principal appraisal, jury. That means you can form a committee of internal external experts, and before the committee, before the jury, the teacher can appear, and before that you can prepare questionnaire and you can get the response from the staff. So that way you can fine tune the teaching learning process, the performance of the teacher, or the intellectual atmosphere of the campus can be fine tuned. So present day education concentrates on increasing the knowledge and skills of the learners, enhancing the focus on higher order learning and professional skills. I told you about six orders, six levels, seven, K2, K3, K4, K5, K6. Remember, understand, apply, analyze, evaluate, create. We have to focus on higher order learning, at least from the third order we have to think. The education philosophy of the institution should bring about educational essential changes in higher education in terms of what we teach, that is the syllabus or the content, how we teach, so knowledge delivery through infrastructure and learning resources, teaching, learning and evaluation process, research, consultants and extension facility and governance and so on and so forth. How we assess and attain outcomes, they are covered in evaluation process and reforms, student performance and learning outcomes, student progression, best practices and institutional distinctiveness, and how we impart values and attitudes, they are covered in extension activities and institutional values and social responsibilities. So IQAC has to play a catalytic role meeting, the formulation of program outcome, program specific outcome, outcome, design and deliver aligned teaching and activities. We have to have proper assessment of attainment of outcomes. So these are the quality initiatives, quality sustenance and quality enhancement. This definition comes up. So what IPC can do is identify the units, you segregate the departments, service administration, offices, research centers, like that. You prepare questionnaire, you give the template for each question, then standard operating procedure, whatever documents that all that you give, you contact the internal and external audit. If it is possible, you rank different units. So departments can be ranked, the service organization can be ranked separately, research centers can be ranked separately. These offices and the libraries, they can be ranked so that there is a healthy competition and you get the quality culture, you fine-tune the quality culture of the institution. So you have to motivate both the teaching and non-teaching staff to volunteer to enhance the quality of higher education. And we have to motivate every staff to make a distinctive contribution regardless of the position or power. That is the contributor paradigm. That is the mantra of quality enhancement. So the IPC has to play the role of a twin tab. What is a twin tab? You change the ship's course, so you move a steering wheel that operates the rudder itself, which then turns the ship. But the rudder can be enormous, perhaps even 10 stories tall on some ocean liners. So what moves this rudder? A tiny second rudder. This is called a twin tab, which is attached to the big rudder. So this tiny second rudder moves the big rudder, then the big rudder moves the entire ship. So every staff, in fact, every member in the IPC should be a twin tab so that you fine-tune the quality culture of the institution. So outcomes define what to teach, how to teach, and how to assess. So what will be one's contribution in order to make a great career, in order to enhance the quality of higher education? This boils down to finding work that taps our talent, fuels our passion, and satisfies our conscience. So have the mantra of quality or mantra of excellence in all your work, especially in teaching, learning process. Then that mantra will tap your talent, will fuel your passion, will satisfy your conscience, make a great career by your contribution to the institution, and in turn to the nation. Your great contribution will make you participate in the nation building exercise, and your contribution will enhance the quality of higher education. With this quote, let me conclude my sharing. We are what we repeatedly do. Excellence then is not an act, but a habit. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, do you hear me, sir? Thank you very much, sir. We shall have.
Some... Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes, sir, I'm hearing.
Yes, sir. We shall have some interaction between participants, sir. They may ask some questions in chat box. And I will...
Okay, sir. Yeah, most welcome.
Yes, sir. Kindly bear with me.
Yeah, I'm waiting for questions.
Yes, sir. Dear participant, kindly text any queries in chat box. We will convey to the resource person. Dear participants, kindly text your queries in chat box. We will forward and we will convey the message to resource person.
Yeah, I am also going through chat box now. If there are questions, I'll... read the question and then we'll have interaction.
Yeah.
one of the
how to there is a question, how to calculate a teacher student ratio
in fixed amount.
A number of students divided by number of teachers, that's all.
Yes.
One. My mail ID, some participants want to have my mail ID. My name LOURDUSAMY. I am typing here my mail ID. LOURDUSAMY. Well, I am not looking. Okay. LOURDUSAMY 15@gmail.com. So my mail ID, I have typed LOURDUSAMY15@gmail.com, or another mail is there, SXCLOURDUSAMY@gmail.com. So I think you have got my mail ID. So how many questions include in SS survey? 21 questions will be there. 20 objective type questions, and then one question students can give response in a descriptive way. So there will be 21 questions. Every year IQAC can conduct in any educational institution, taking the same questionnaire, and you can conduct feedback so that the students get accustomed to responding through net. You can send these questions to their email ID. I'll let them send their response through net. You can prepare students that way. Apart from these participants, do you also have a participants channeled through YouTube or only?
Yes sir. This also in YouTube.
In YouTube, how many are going to listen? How many have listened?
Sir, around 40 viewers are viewed, sir. Around 40.
So you have live view or later you will go.
No, sir, it is live.
Okay. So through this, how many are listening? Through YouTube, how many are listening?
At present, 100 are there, sir. Yes, 100.
Okay. So outside WebEx, through YouTube,
total 140, sir. 140.
Okay. Oh, good.
Sir, another question.
Okay.
There is any separate manual for special institute, like specially physically able students?
Yeah, physically different students.
No. If the institute is specially designed.
If the institution?
Special institution. They are only a special person with disabilities.
Yeah, you have to get a disability certificate from the concerned person, and you should keep it ready, because you have to upload the percentage of disability they have and the supporting documents also you have to upload. So when you admit the students from that category, you have to get certificates.
Dear participant, if you have any queries, kindly text in. Dear participants, thank you very much. It's a time to propose one of the things. May I request, yes, Manjula Gautam, to propose one of the things.
Sir, what is the date of the meeting? Good afternoon. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, madam. Yes, madam. Go ahead.
Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to be here to propose vote of thanks on behalf of the college in presenting our gratitude to Dr. A. Laudusamy, IQAC coordinator, St. Xavier College, Palamkottai, for being the resource person and accepting our proposal at the last moment to take over the session on the topic teaching, learning and evaluation process, which he explained in an elaborative manner. Not only the key indicators has been explained, but also each and every metrics he has explained with the examples. Thank you so much, sir. Yes, I would like to I would like to extend our gratefulness to Dr. R. Jagannathan, principal in charge, Rajapalayam Raju College, for being the pillar of support during this process of the program. And also thank Mr. N. Ramesh, vice principal of the college and head assistant professor in Department of Chemistry, for encouraging us throughout the program. Now I'd like to thank our leader or coordinator, IQAC coordinator, Mr. R. Vishnu Shankar. He led the team very efficiently from the beginning, from the organization till the end. He's been very supportive. Thank you so much, sir. I would like to also thank the organizing committee, the IQAC members, and of course technicians, especially Mr. Shatish, who has been in and around the program and been running around for all the technical problems we have faced. Their background work has helped us a lot to present the program in the foreground. Thank you so much. And finally, I would like to thank the participants for being very patient during the complete 7-day program. And I wish all the best for all the colleges to be ready for the next NAC process they are going to have. And I feel that this program will definitely help them for the process. Thank you so much. Over to you, Vishnu sir.
Thank you very much, madam. It's a great opportunity given for me in the pandemic period to conduct 70s faculty development program and revise accreditation process framework of NAC. I thankful to every resource person who accepted our invitation and acted as a resource person for the past 7 days. I thank each and everyone. A special thanks to today's resource person, Dr. A. Laudusamy sir, for spending the past 2 hours with us and shared his views on teaching learning evaluation. I personally thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Dear participants, by today, we will process your certificates within 5 working days. Thank you, Unal. Have a good day. Thank you.